Welcome to THA Talks, for free thought and open minds. Hello people, coming to you from London, UK and out to the universe. I'm Paul Obertelli and this is edition 48 of THA Talks, brought to you by Theo Humanist Arts. Here at THA Talks, we bring you weekly shows and all the best interviews we can get our sticky mitts on. Just go to www.thatalks.com to listen to or to download all our free content. Our talks include news, conspiracies, spirituality, the occult, science, history, art, philosophy, religion and much more. If you'd like to get hold of us and send us any of your thoughts or ideas for the show, maybe a request for a potential guest, you can do so by emailing info@thatalks.com. That's info@thatalks.com. Also, if you're digging what we're doing here, which we hope you are, you can subscribe using our RSS feed or through various podcast directories like iTunes or Stitcher. Again, you can visit our website for more details on that. As usual, I am joined here today from the other side of London. It is a surge. It is a dramaturge, David Parry.
Oh, Paul, sex, sex, sex. Is that all people talk about nowadays?
Well, it's could think of worse things.
Hey, I'm a model, if you know what I mean, and I do my little dirt on the catwalk. On the catwalk. I'm too sexy for this shirt. There are other subjects as well, however.
Well, that's true. Mountain climbing, for instance.
Well, a certain person we both know was an expert mountain climber, of course, an international chess player.
Right, well, exactly. And he was also, some would say, he's a very influential figure on paganism. Some would say not. Some would say he was fantastic. Some would say he was demonic. Very controversial chap we've got on.
Well, yeah, I mean, he's controversial, big owl. I mean, he's a big reputation. I don't get me wrong. I think he's a one-off. He's a unique individual. Mm. I personally think he's detrimental to modern neo-paganism.
Yeah.
And I don't think he's really speaking from a pagan perspective. Yeah. But I'm sure that will come out as we go along. And that said, as someone actually who is interested in his work, but I just don't think it's paganism.
Well, actually, we won't be getting Aleister Crowley on. We'll be getting Lon on. But basically, yeah, this week we'll be speaking with Lon Milo DuQuette. Lon is an American musician, writer, lecturer, and he's the national and international governing officer of Ordo Templi Orientis, otherwise known as the OTO. And a lot of his books have helped people understand the works of Aleister Crowley and Thelema. So we won't be getting Aleister Crowley on, we'll be getting Lon Milo DuQuette on.
Well, that's good too. Did you actually make the Freudian slip of calling him a lecturer?
Yes, I did.
Oh, well, there we are.
Lecturer is what I meant to say. But anyway, before we get Lon on, which I'm very much looking forward to doing, and we're going to check out one of his fantastic tunes called I'm Scared.
My life's in constant danger. I'm threatened by each stranger. I'm scared they'll club and stab me. Scared kidnappers will nab me. I'm scared of home intrusion and cultural infusion. I'm scared of immigrants and teens in drooping pants. I'm scared of sudden sounds. I'm scared of mimes and clowns. I'm scared of boys in hoodies. Scared they will steal my goodies. I'm scared of car hijackers. Scared of computer hackers. I'm scared of mysticism. That devil communism. I'm scared of social welfare and universal healthcare. I'm scared of foreign accents. I'm scared of paying taxes. I'm scared of other races and unfamiliar faces. I'm scared of intellectuals. I'm scared of homosexuals. I'm scared of bureaucrats. I'm scared of Democrats. I'm scared of Satanists. Scared of psychiatrists. Scared of my medications. Fear your college educations. I'm scared of revolution, theory of evolution.
I'm scared
of knocks upon my door.
I'm scared
of homeless and the poor.
I'm scared
that guys will disrespect me.
I'm scared
that girls will just reject me.
I'm scared
that I'll look like a fool.
I'm scared
just like I did in school.
I'm scared
my mother's ghost still haunts me.
I'm scared
dad's disapproval taunts me. I'm scared of darkened streets. I'm scared of halal meats. I'm scared of NSA, UN and CIA. I'm scared of my own shadow. I'm scared of Rachel Maddow. I'm not an evil fellow. My spine's just painted yellow. I'm scared each waking hour. In dreams I cringe and cower. Scared that I have no power. Wish I lived in a tower. Scared of my powerlessness. Scared of my cowardice-ness. That's why I carry a gun.
Hello, Lon. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me on.
That's our pleasure. Okay, you're known for your involvement in the OTO and your books on magic and Aleister Crowley, very well known in that area. But you're also a musician. We just listened to one of your tracks, I'm Scared, which is fantastic. So before we indulge into the occult stuff and so on, could you sort of let us know what you've been up to with your sort of musical ventures recently? Because I understand you've won a few awards and been very busy. So how's it all going? Let us know a bit about that.
Well, I've been very lucky, and the music has in the last several years been sort of an extension of my magical work. The poetry of my literature, if I venture to call it that, has taken a musical twist in how I'm choosing a vehicle. And currently, the big thing is I'm in a songwriting contest that's sponsored by the organization, Guitar Center, a very big nationwide chain of guitar stores. And the prize is incredibly attractive. There's $25,000 and a record made by Don Wass and appearance on the Jimmy Kimmel Live show and things like that. And I thought, well, this is a good opportunity to see if I can get my songs out there, because what could it hurt? You know, I'm a senior citizen. I'll go for the pity vote, you know?
Yeah.
Currently, out of over 12,000 songwriters who've entered, I'm number one.
That's fantastic.
And the contest ends November 9th, so I'm going to try to hold on to first place and get into the next round anyway with that. So.
And is this a voting system, is it? Or?
Well, it's the first round is a vote popularity thing. Then the top five... are then really the songs themselves are really given the scrutiny as far as whether they're legitimate works of art and all of that, and eventually there would be a performance at the Troubadour in Hollywood and all of that, but none of that would go forward unless I do really well in this first round. And the first round is more or less a popularity contest, but they count how many times my videos are played, and so I've put five of my videos on the site. You just go to Guitar Center contest, and you'll go to the first page, and I'm right on the first page, and you just click on my first video, which is a song called Class Warfare, and it automatically plays through all five, and at the end of 20 minutes there, or however long it takes to play those five, you've cast five votes my way.
Okay, so our listeners should take note of that. I mean, we've just, as I said, we just played one of your tracks, I'm Scared, which I think is very relevant of the times, to be honest. It was, it put a grin on my face, because it was, very, very relevant of times. I think people are so afraid and stuff, but thankfully they don't always have a gun in their pocket there.
right. So, my work, I try to, I'm not a songwriter for just songwriting's sake. I'm trying to give voice to my attitudes and my opinions and my spiritual understanding of things. But I try to do it in a way that's not preachy, but that the song itself delivers a message just in and of itself. So.
Yeah, I think with songs, as long as it's coming from the heart, if it comes from the right place, it always lands in the right place. You know, it's very spiritual thing. Yeah. So I mean, you've also, moving on to some of your writing and magic and so on, you've got a new book, Homemade Magic, coming out.
Yeah, it's already out, and it's doing pretty good. It's called Homemade Magic.
Okay, that sounds pretty self-explanatory then.
Well, yeah, as you might know, quite a few of my books are sort of along the lines of mystical textbooks, commentaries on tarot or Qabalah or Aleister Crowley's work. But three of my books so far have been what does all of this actually mean to somebody's life? You know, it's if you've ever met a hermetic Kabbalist, they can play with numbers in your name and talk about Kabbalistic levels of consciousness and everything else. But when you ask them, well, yeah, but actually, what does this mean to you?
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
What does it mean in your life? You know.
Yeah, a lot of people who I spoke to about you coming on the show, a lot of feedback was, oh, Lon, you know, he's a really great writer. You know, he helped me understand Aleister Crowley, because Aleister Crowley was sometimes, you know, too smart for his own good, you know?
Yeah.
You'd often have to read the page about sort of 10 times before you understand it.
Right.
And a lot of your books do make it a lot easier for people to understand where he was coming from and what it all meant, basically. So I've noticed that myself, and I think you're pretty much viewed as the guy that knows a lot about him.
Well, my books are mostly a way for me to try to organize my thoughts so I can explain it to myself,
right?
And so that's I've been lucky enough to get publishers to publish my my attempts to explain this stuff to myself. And Homemade Magic is like my third sort of autobiographical, it's anecdotal. And I more or less explain magic in terms of what it means in somebody's practical home life, how this study, this way of thought integrates, and how it hopefully is a source of at least a little bit of evolutionary self-transformation. And I give lots of examples of all my failures and things that have blown up in my face and where I've gotten things wrong. So it turns out to be kind of funny.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, obviously one thing that comes up when you talk about Aleister Crowley, is the evil aspect of it. I mean, obviously more and more people are understanding magic now, and I mean, from an outside perspective, obviously a lot of people just view people like Aleister Crowley as some satanic dodgy guy they wouldn't want anything to do with. When you get involved and just understand a little bit more about the occult world, you start to see him more for what he really is. But even in the pagan world and the occult world, you still get people that kind of take a dislike into Crowley. I mean, you're obviously very much into the OTO and Crowley's work. Do you find, I mean, as a source, as a platform for magic, obviously you find it a very good place to do. I mean, what are your views on the controversial side of Crowley and people that think, oh, maybe it's not a good footing to practice magic on? I mean, obviously you disagree, but could you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, anyway, you know, it doesn't. Everybody is different, and everybody is at a different stage of development, and everybody has their own things that. Baggage that they have to rid themselves of and challenges they have to overcome. And one of the big, most primary, most important things that must be overcome in any sort of spiritual study, practice, order of thought, whatever you want to call it, the most important thing to overcome is fear. If Crowley provides a seeker nothing else, he definitely gives them an instant opportunity to deal with and face their own fear. So Crowley was quite happy to frighten anybody who is capable of being unduly, irrationally frightened. And it's almost like if you're superstitious enough to buy in to the irrational, and I really mean irrational, stories of Crowley's type of magic, if you're so superstitious that you're still capable of being that afraid, Crowley wouldn't want you to be studying this stuff because you're just not grown up enough. And I mean this in the very, very kindest, compassionate way. You're just not grown up enough to tackle serious spiritual disciplines, and so basically it comes to if you're presently incapable of finding the light in the darkness, you're not going to be able to find the light anywhere. Okay, so Crowley is in a way obliging us, even at the beginning, to say, okay, this scares the daylights out of me. He's talking about demons, and he's talking about Babylon, and all of his imagery is so dark, and all of this. But you know, I think the guy is absolutely brilliant, and some people that I really respect, you know, are very admire his work and admire where he's going. Maybe I'll just bite the bullet and get over my baby irrational fear of the dark, see what he's actually getting at. And that's what Crowley, with his horrible reputation, you know, he told people, if people accused him of being a cannibal, you know, he wasn't a cannibal, you know, but if somebody is so stupid and superstitious to accuse you of being a cannibal, doesn't your own sense of humor and playfulness want to say, yeah, I'm a cannibal, sure, I did that?
Yeah, I mean, I've read various books from Aleister Crowley and checked him out, and I find that when I did actually realize that a lot of the time he has actually got a very good sense of humor, all of a sudden his character just you kind of got him a little bit more. I mean, there's obviously there was still that dark element to him. I mean, we've all got our own character, obviously, but I think that side of it kind of did twist it a little bit. And I do, you know, I got the idea that the elimination of, or I suppose the sedation of the ego is something that's very important within magic. And again, this is a part that when you understand that that's what he was trying to do, whether people like the way he was doing it or not, at the end of the day, that is what he was trying to do. I kind of got that side of it. One thing that that I find very interesting, and I've heard on the internet a lot of speculation and guessing and talk on it, is the relationship that Aleister Crowley had with Gerald Gardner and his influence on modern paganism and particularly Wicca. What's your take on that? What do you think of that?
Well, they were great friends. I mean, they truly were great personal friends. Mm. And especially in both their later years. And Gerald was, as a matter of fact, when Crowley died, Rita Harris, the wonderful artist that painted the Thoth deck, she thought that Gerald Gardner had inherited the leadership of the OTO. He was that involved, and Crowley was seeing this idea of sort of the intellectual indoor magic of the Golden Dawn, and even his own AA and the OTO as such. He saw that as being of interest and of benefit to a pretty select group of sort of intellectual magicians.
Mm.
But he and Gerald said, you know, this new age thought, this new age thought is very much like the pagan way of looking at things. You know how you have more in common with your grandmother than you do your mother?
Yeah.
Sometimes. Well, ages. You have almost more in common with two ages ago than you do with the previous age, because the age just preceding you, you're rebelling against. Okay? So there's a certain amount of hearkening back. There's a certain amount of natural pagan liberty that is suggested by the new Thelemic do what thou wilt current, if you want to call it a current. And Crowley was very supportive of Gerald's idea of, gee, let's resurrect sort of the right hemisphere pagan thing, because there'll be many, 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 many more people interested in that form of religious expression than are going to want to dress up in suits and strut around in a darkened lodge room, yeah. You know. And so he was very supportive of it. And of course, you see elements of the Gnostic Mass in Gerald's works, his Books of Shadows and everything, and the Do What Thou Wilt and Harm None.
I think there's definite influences. I think what happens in the pagan community is you either get people that just really defend Aleister Crowley and sort of say, you know, people got him wrong, leave him alone, try and, you know, sort of open your mind a bit and work out what he's actually saying. And then from the other side of it, they tend to sort of keep him at arm's length, say, oh, he's not a pagan, he was bad news, you know, don't associate him with us. They like, because of his name, they just detach themselves. So you sort of get a balance of that within the pagan world. Would you regard the OTO and Thelema, do you regard that as a pagan religion, or is it something different?
From my definition of pagan, no.
Mm.
But from a broader, more generic view of pagan, you know, non-Christian, non-Abrahamic, religion of personal liberty and harmony with nature, that broad definition of paganism, of course, Thelema falls into that quite naturally.
Mm.
But when we're getting right down to the almost this, and you can see the pagan archetypes in Nuit and Hadit and Babylon and the Beast and all of that. You can see that there, but the very narrow, almost anthropomorphic. I worship the goddess, and I'm sorry, Thelema obliges you to move out of that dualism.
Mm. Yeah.
And the comment I hear a lot in the pagan community, because I go speak at pagan events all the time. At the big Earth Day or the big climate march in New York City, I held the pagan flag. Okay.
Oh, cool.
I was the flag that said pagan. Okay.
Yeah.
I held it in that parade.
Excellent.
Because from my big generic point of view, that I definitely fall into that category.
Mm.
But this sort of narrow focused thing where you're, well, are you solar or are you lunar?
Mm.
Give me a break. Okay. It's got to be bigger than solar and lunar.
Yeah.
When I'm talking to people in another discussion, I've got a lecture that's called Good and Evil, Get Over It.
Yeah.
Okay. So if your deity is so small it has an opposite, then your deity isn't really a deity yet. Okay, it's just not big enough yet if it's got an opposite. And so to try to break up, say, Thelemic thought and say, well, that's solar phallic. Well, I'm sorry, you can't, if your phallus doesn't have some place to stick itself, okay, it's not really a phallus yet, okay? So don't give me solar lunar BS, okay? It's gotta transcend them both. The spiritual worldview has to be across the abyss, where all opposites are reconciled, where everything equals out. And so when the point of view of your definition of paganism is, say, lunar or female, then I have to get off that train. Okay, because it's bigger than both the sun and the moon. That's why the symbol has always been the symbol of the beast. Mark of the beast is the sun and moon conjoined.
Mm. Okay. Well, other issue that is pointed towards the pagan and the occult world. Let's look at Wicca, practicing the ritual sky clad. Obviously, from an outside perspective, it's kind of looked down on by certain groups, not really understanding what the ins and outs of it is. And the OTO and Thelema doesn't come without its own finger pointers and groups that are attacking it because of the so-called sexual content that is supposed to be there or isn't there. Without disrespecting any oaths that you may have taken in your initiations, could you sort of shed a bit of light and address some of these issues targeted at the OTO and Thelema, particularly from outsiders?
Sure. There's nowhere in the OTO where you're honor bound not to, or oath bound not to discuss stuff like that. Okay. We're just oath-bound not to tell you what the handshake is.
Yeah, right, yeah.
Okay.
Just before you say, because I've been on forums, and I'm not going to repeat some of the accusations thrown by a lot of ignorant people, so I just thought I'd touch on the subject and stuff, because it is out there. You're obviously getting accused of a lot of unfounded stuff and stuff, but at the same time, there is obviously a sexual element to it. But.
The magic of the OTO, the central... magic, the OTO's holy grail, the subject matter of it is sexual, because the subject matter of every breath you take is in a way sexual. So the idea that ecstasy itself is a level of consciousness a transcendent level of consciousness where ego and the false identified self is dissolved into Godhead for a split second. Even everybody on earth, you and me are sitting here because our parents had that moment. Okay. Yeah. Okay. It is the supreme creative act. When your consciousness is wall to wall everything, there is nothing that you cannot create in it. When you become everything, you can create anything. That's the thing. That's the theory. And the imagery and the pageantry of OTO degree work is intended to open up that realization. So it's not a piece of information that you read in a book, but it is something that you, all by yourself, in the privacy of your own life, realize. There is no OTO degree where you're asked, required, suggested to perform an act of sexual act with anybody. There is no degree ceremony. You are not obliged to let anybody do you, and you're not obliged to do anybody. If you're going to practice sexual magic, you're going to have your own charm, and you're going to have to get your own boyfriend or girlfriend and do it on your own privately someplace. You're not. I've had people join the OTO and expect us to provide him a girlfriend. And I got to tell them right away, boy, are you going to be disappointed. I've gone through every one of these degrees, absolutely every one of them, and there is no time or place where I was even asked to do anything against my will. And I was not obliged to do or suggested that it needed to be done, any act, any sexual act with anybody. But I tell you, what you learn in tantric yoga, what you learn in Crowley-esque Thelemic magic, is the secret of sexuality. But you're going to have to learn it yourself, and you're going to have to practice it yourself. And there's nothing that's ever happened to me in an OTO initiation that I couldn't have invited my grandmother to witness.
Okay.
Is that clear enough?
Yeah, that's very well said and very, very passionately as well. Okay. I think David's itching to step in. So, David, what are you making of this?
Gosh. Well, firstly, it's very hard to see Lon as a senior citizen. So I suppose that's the first thing.
Oh, bless you, my son.
Well, you're too vibrant. You're obviously not in any real sense, my dear friend. I need to set the record straight about one thing before we go any further. I did not say to the press that Aleister Crowley was the Madonna of his day. I want to take that back now. What I did say to the press was that, yes, I thought he was a national treasure. I did say that. And what I had in mind was the art. I mean, he's such a creative individual, and to my mind, years and years ahead of German performance art. I mean, a staggering achievement. That's never written about, and needs to be written about. Lon, I mean, one thing that you've touched upon that I think I need to flesh out a bit more. I would assume that the big idea behind modern paganism is ecology. I would also assume that that's not really the big idea behind Thelema stroke OTO initiatic work. My perception, I suspect, is that Aleister Crowley's work makes more sense within the Freemasonic tradition. What would you care to say to that?
No, I absolutely agree. That's why you found me marching under the pagan banner at the climate march, in New York City, and not under the OTO banner, because the OTO is that may be the focus of many of the members of the OTO, but it's not the focus, specific focus of the OTO itself. There may it is conceivable that it is somebody's will to be as socially, as ecologically, as economically opposed to my personal ideals as anybody. The OTO or Thelema doesn't tell you to be a left-winger or a right-winger or an anarchist or a fascist or a communist. As a matter of fact, Thelema says, you know, it is conceivable that you could consider yourself any of those things or all of those things and still be doing your will, doing what you need to do in this incarnation to further your own will. And it may be at any time that you choose to be a male or a female, or you choose to be a right winger or a left winger. Thelema backs up the camera and takes a big wide angle shot of the nature of being. And and most of us are operating on a day-to-day basis on a much more focused level. I mean, I got lots of friends in the OTO who are wonderful magicians who are doing whatever they think they need to be doing to express and fulfill their wills, who vote completely different than me. Okay. I've got the Thelemic brothers and sisters whose focus and what they need to be focusing on is totally different than mine. But we are both doing whatever we need to do to try to discover what our will is and do it. And can't you see how the air would be let out of that by saying, oh, well, you know, you can't really be doing your will unless you are an environmentalist.
Very interesting.
You can't say that. You just can't say it. I can say you're not a good citizen. you're not a good world citizen, you know, but I can never say you're not doing your will. That's something between you and your will.
Well, let me throw something at you. A dear friend of mine is Freya Aswin, and she said to me a couple of years ago it was her will to follow the Nordic gods, and it astonished her that so many people in Thelema not so much followed the ancient gods of the gods of ancient Egypt, but actually Crowley's will to do with the gods of ancient Egypt. What do you think of that, Lon?
I think she was absolutely correct. I know Freya. She's a marvelous, marvelous person. And she's absolutely right. All I'm saying is the people that she encountered in Thelema that were so short-sighted and had such a misunderstanding of what Thelema was that they would worship Crowley or even worship anything as small as the anthropomorphic deities of any tradition. She ran into people that were thinking they were Thelemites. She was running into people that were thinking they were being Thelemic. Okay, but can you see who the Thelemite was in the conversation? It was Freya's will to worship the Nordic gods. She knew what she was doing, and she would never say, she would never, I'm putting words in her mouth, but I'm sure there are words that would go in her mouth. She would never tell me it was my will to worship anything or nothing.
I'm pleased we both know Freya. I mean, she's a force of nature more than a human being.
She is. She is. Yeah. you know, we're all lucky in the circle of friends and acquaintances that we run into to run in from time to time to people who are, by all definitions of the term, living saints.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you know them when you see them. and she is just a marvel. I love her.
Yeah.
Dearly. Yeah. And she's so outspoken. She's terribly outspoken that I can imagine that there is something that she could or would or would like to say that would just absolutely rub everybody the wrong way at one time or another. But it's not my job. Okay, she's doing her job. It's not my job to not be rubbed the wrong way.
You know? Yeah, so. Lon, your work has all the precision and all the fluidity of a Freemason's hand. Are you a Freemason?
Yes, I joined the Masons when I was 50.
Wow.
I joined my dad's old lodge, and I enjoy my Masonic experience immensely, but I don't think I would have enjoyed it had I joined as a young man. I would have said, "What the hell are these old farts doing?" Jeez. But after 30 some years of occult exposure, I could savor absolutely every moment of my Masonic experience. And I'm not saying this in a trying to say I have a superior point of view or anything else, but I am saying that almost every aspect of especially the ceremonies of entry, passing, and raising, I found to be a treasure house of occult meaning. Not only that, but I enjoyed, I wallowed in my Masonic experience as a real high initiation. Whether the old farts who were there doing it or not knew what they were doing the work of hierophants. And because they did it exactly the way that they were taught and the way that their fathers were taught and their fathers' fathers and their fathers' fathers, they didn't even need to know what they were doing. They were just doing it. It was if the initiatory impact of Freemasonry was handed to me across the centuries in a locked box with which these guys neither knew nor cared that there was a key to it. So I really do like my enjoy my Masonic experience. I went on to the Scottish Rite, which is really easy to go through all or to be a 32nd degree Mason in the United States, but it's rather more difficult to actually audit and experience all 32 of the degrees. And I took the time to audit absolutely every one of the degrees of the Scottish Rite. And I'm just totally blown away at every step. And I look around at my fellow Masons, and I'm going, "Isn't this great?" And they go, "Huh? Well, in 20 minutes we can have pie, you know, and coffee."
Lon, you're a very fine man indeed. Let me throw one last thing at you before we get young Obertelli back on. Your creativity has a very wide range. It's exceedingly impressive. Would you say any of that is because of the OTO or Freemasonry, or has that given you structures or helped you kick against structures to make those things manifest? I mean, as a naturally, you must be a naturally creative individual. Have those things been seminal in your expression, or do you think they're sort of tangential?
Actually, I, I, I think that my, especially my OTO experience, because I've been in the OTO longer than I've been in Freemasonry, has been a continual catalyst in my creative life. And I have to say that I have been positively, at least from my current point of view, I've been positively mutated through my work, my understanding, my meditations on the Thelemic and OTO experience. And I think that more than anything has allowed me to appreciate the Freemasonic experience.
Incredibly interesting. More power to your elbow, Paul.
Yeah, I think talking of Freemasonry, I think it was true that wasn't Aleister Crowley not accepted within the official bodies of Freemasonry, even though he was obviously quite passionate about learning about it at the time. Is that true?
Well, it depends on whose National Grand Lodge you owe allegiance to. Mm. The Scottish Rite I belong to is not the Sir No Scottish Rite, and neither one of them recognize each other. I belong to the what would be called the York Rite of my Blue Lodge, and Grand Lodge of England may or may not recognize that, but they do recognize the Prince Hall Lodges. Okay, and all of this goes back to which club recognizes which club. Crowley belonged to a Masonic lodge in Paris that was full of expats, English-speaking expats, and one Grand Lodge or one Grand Orient of France may have recognized it, but the Grand Lodge of England didn't, and so Masonic snobs of any given variety can prove without a shadow of doubt that none of us are Masons.
Mm. Yeah, I suppose if you look at it that way, yeah, that's true. Keeping on that subject of different lodges, different groups, because as I understand it, the OTO, so I've heard, has got different groups separate from themselves. I just wondered, is that true? And also, is there a certain group that is actually a direct lineage from Aleister Crowley, the original OTO?
Well, the I don't see that there are many OTOs. I just see that there's one OTO.
Oh, okay.
OTO is not so much like a generic term for Thelemic magic, early on in 1975, I was initiated by Grady McMurtry and Phyllis Seckler. Phyllis Seckler got her ninth degree from Carl Germer, who was the head of the OTO after Crowley's death, and Grady McMurtry got his ninth degree from Aleister Crowley.
Right.
He also had, you know, certain letters of authorization that were satisfactory in my eyes to resurrect or keep the OTO from actually dissolving. As far as I know, there were six living people of that, of the original Agape Lodge, which was the only active lodge of the OTO during Crowley's later years.
Mm.
And so I said, gee, nobody's got anything better than this. And to tell you the truth, lineage means jack shit. You know, if there isn't something behind it. And I sense the momentum of two old contemporaries of Crowley, both of whom were, as far as the OTO degrees go, the highest degrees, one given by Crowley himself, one given by Carl Germer, Crowley's successor. I thought, well, I guess I'm pretty much joining the the right current here, and I think there's only six living members when I was initiated in 75. There might have been a few more. But anybody else that would, you know, it's been demonstrated in various courts and things over the years. And just recently, the OTO, well, over the last 10 years, there's been the creation of five grand lodges, the national lodges in the United States and Australia, Croatia, Italy, and of course England, and those national grandmasters have according to the Crowley's own bylaws and everything else elected an international head. The OTO has never manifested was never manifested according to Crowley's plan in Crowley's life, and it is now. And there's what, maybe 3,000 or 4,000 members worldwide. That's not very much, but as true magical societies go, it's the biggest one in the world. I don't want to lean back and be a book of the law thumper, but success is your proof. And if that would be your only criteria, then I rest my case. But the point is, when anybody joins the OTO, just the act of them joining the OTO changes the OTO. It becomes part of them. They become part of it. It's a very organic thing. And if you think that you can do any magical work or not do any magical work because of your membership in or non-membership in any organization, boy, you're missing the big point. We're all in this alone. All magical work is done solo. No matter how many people you cram into the room and dress up in robes and strut around in the dark, you're still doing the magic by yourself. And if you think an organization is going to give you anything or take anything away from you, you don't have any idea what you're involved in.
Yeah, no, that makes sense. I was actually going to ask you, I was going to say, do you think that the OTO is actually growing in the modern day? Is it getting bigger and bigger? But you kind of touched on that already. So,
well, it's getting bigger, but it's not getting bigger so in the same dramatic way as organizations that really want your money or want to hook you into a cult. Okay, it's not growing as big as Scientology, in other words. Okay, yeah. Because it demands different things from you. It demands your own self-liberty, and your own self-liberty isn't really conducive to great organizational growth.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, that is another issue that I have come across. You know, it's on the internet and so on, that Scientology was inspired or the OTO created Scientology. And so on, which I'm sure I've come across some information that Aleister Crowley didn't even like Hubbard. I'm not sure if that's genuine or not, but it wouldn't surprise me.
Yeah, Crowley wrote he was concerned that Jack Parsons had aligned himself or had become involved with a quote con man, He was really concerned with what Parsons was up to, and indeed part of Grady McMurtry's letters of authorization were sort of keep an eye on that situation. So Hubbard never belonged to the OTO. He was never an OTO initiate. He is quoted as saying in a lecture, "My friend Aleister Crowley," but he never wrote a letter to or that we know of, and Crowley never wrote a letter to Hubbard. They were never in communication, and what communication Crowley had concerning Hubbard was very uncomplimentary.
Yeah, I think I saw something that when he actually claimed he was a friend of Aleister Crowley, he pronounced his name wrong. He said Aleister Crowley, which everyone knows Crowley preferred to be called Crowley. He was talking about the book Magic and Theory and Practice, and because the author was the Master Therian, he said you should buy his book, The Master Therian. So he pronounced the author of the book as a title, so it kind of gives you an idea of how much he really knew Crowley. That was interesting.
He really didn't, and I don't want to trash another organization, but because I don't want to trash another organization, there's really not much I have to say.
Okay, no, that's fair enough. We are heading towards that time. So, David, do you want to jump add anything quickly here before we wrap it up?
Well, apart from being exhausted by international exams at the University of London, God bless those students. I think Lon knows exactly what I mean. God bless those students. And the fact I keep hearing Skype switch off. That's you, isn't it, Obertelli? That's freaking me out.
No, I think that's just technology screwing
me. I'm listening. I'm watching. Lon, there's one last thing. We've obviously got to have you back on the show. We've got thousands of things to talk about. I think that's obvious. Oh, my friend, thank you. I mean, you've got to. A dear friend of mine, another friend of mine, Richard Rudgley, the anthropologist, I think he's on the verge of writing something against Crowley and neo-paganism in the sense that he thinks he's an obstacle. Now, you probably know I think I'm cautious about Crowley and his influence upon neo-paganism, but I'm not sure I think he's an obstacle. What I think Richard has in mind, and I hate talking about essays before they're written, but what I think he's got in mind is all this sort of New Testament Book of Revelations imagery and of the great beast, the Whore of Babylon. And I think he sees that as appealing far too much to a Christian or post-Christian mindset to make it truly relevant for neo-paganism. What do you think of that?
I think he's probably got a good point there as far as he goes. We got to remember that if we're going to crystallize Crowley into what he did, what he said, how he said it, then we're not growing in Thelema the way that I think Crowley would have wanted us to grow. Even John Dee and Edward Kelly, we understand the magic of John Dee and Edward Kelly, not because we blindly follow in the same way as we would follow a doctrine, but because we are obliged to put ourselves in the environment that they were in, the spiritual and religious environment that they were operating in, and the vocabulary that they were using. When Crowley talks about Babylon and the beast, he could just as easily be talking about Chokmah and Bina. He could have just as easily been talking about Shiva and Shakti in other cultures. And your friend is absolutely right that if we are so short-sighted as to demand ourselves to think about these abstract concepts in the concrete vocabulary of Aleister Crowley, then we're going to be stuck with New Testament lingo, New Testament language, but it's just a matter of the vocabulary that we're using. And so if that in itself can be an obstacle. And if that's going to be his point, then I'm going to have to come down in agreement with him, because I get emails all the time from well-meaning spiritual seekers, if you want to call them seekers, who obviously were raised in an evangelical Christian environment, the same way that Crowley was. Mm. Obviously inspired and thrilled by the Crowley's negative reaction to that, who are very, very quick to anthropomorphize the goddess Babylon, who are only too quick to anthropomorphize the beast 666. Okay, they're literally just being evangelical Christians throwing a fit. Okay, and if your idea of your new spiritual step is just doing whatever it takes to sort of thumb your nose at your parents, then Aleister Crowley's imagery, the nomenclature, the vocabulary, of Thelema is going to be an obstacle in your progress. You're going to have to raise yourself above that. And I think Crowley would have wanted us to raise ourselves above that.
My dear friend, the wisdom of the Americas lives on. We must at least be Facebook friends, but I'm already counting you as a friend, Lon. It's a sheer joy to have spoken to you this evening.
Well, it's been my pleasure entirely, and I hope we can do it again sometime.
Bless you.
Yeah,
all that's me done for this evening.
Yeah, it's been very interesting. We really appreciate you coming on. And if you're ever in the UK, and please get yourself to some pagan events, because David and I would love to come down and buy you a couple drinks.
Good. Well, I go down when I'm in London. I always show up at one moot or another.
So. Yeah. Oh, excellent. Well, we'll certainly keep an eye out for you and come and say hi. Would you like to let our listeners just remind them about your competition, what they need to do to help you out with that one spot?
Please, until November 9th, every day until November 9th, if you would just go to the Guitar Center Songwriter Contest, just search that, Google that, Guitar Center Songwriter Contest. My face usually will show up there on the first page. Just click on my videos. There's 5 short videos, and every time you play my video, you cast another vote. If you listen to all 5, that's 5 votes. I'm currently in first place out of 12,000, and it could mean a lot to my career. And I will be able to sing Sweet Babylon on the Jimmy Kimmel show.
That's brilliant. Well, we'll certainly go and do that. And it's been a pleasure.
My pleasure's mine.
Lon Milo DuQuette. Really enjoyed that. What do you think, Dave?
A genial and intelligent man, a true American sage. I'm won over. I'm not sure that Thelema is pagan, but I'm willing to talk to him for hours.
Yeah, and it's an interesting, lovely guy as well. Lovely to deal with, and really enjoyed the interview. So,
well, Paul, we've got to have him back on. I hope he meant that. You know, I could talk to him for all night. I could talk all night. He knows his business, and he's got a sense of humour. My God, we need more people like that in the world.
Yeah, absolutely. No, yeah, very good. Listeners, please send us in your thoughts of the interview. It's always great to hear your feedback. We've been getting lots of emails and letters come through from listeners now. We're quite happy with that, because it does give us something to reflect on with the show and to keep building it and coming up with new ideas and stuff. So anything you've heard here today, or you'd like to get us to get Lon back on and talk to him about, please send us your thoughts, because that's what we want.
And remember, we're coming up to season 2, 20 whatever, next year, season 2. So we need your thoughts now.
Yeah, it's been a good year. We've kind of done what we wanted to do with the show. We've built up our archive, and you guys have been downloading the show, so we really do appreciate that. Hope you keep enjoying it and downloading and linking the show to your friends, because that's what we've relied on this year. And you've come through trumps.
And we love you.
Excellent. Well, coming up on the show, we've got Dirk Brueri. Again, I've got to find out if that is how I pronounce his second name, because I haven't met him personally. It's all been done over emails and so on, so I'm just going by my own sort of take on that name there. But he can tell me off on the interview if I've got that wrong. Also, we've got Tracy R. Twyman coming on the show for her second appearance with her new book. Some more interesting stuff there. That's going to be good to touch on that stuff. Ron Moorhead, a researcher on Bigfoot, who's actually got some recordings. He claims is actually recordings of Bigfoot out in the wilderness there. So that is going to be something I'm sure you're all going to want to check out. That's really interesting. And a lot more guests coming up, and we've got sort of a dialogue going with some really interesting speakers of all sorts, because that's what we do like to get on THA Talks. We like to spread our message around to everyone and bring them onto the show and speak their mind and come and enlighten us all, David.
Let them come on and strut their stuff. That's what I say.
Anyway, till next time, I think it's time to go. Bye.
Cowsy, cowsy.